The two lessons that were read to us this morning, Genesis 35, 1 to 15, and Matthew 5, 1 to 15, the two lessons are saying the same thing. And for that reason, I'm going to discuss the two at the same time. When Jacob was with Laban, God told him, it is time for you to go back home. And as you are prepared to go back home, build for me an altar. If you go through the scriptures, many men of God have built altar for God in the past. Abraham built an altar for God when God instructed him that he's going to Mount Moriah to sacrifice Isaac. Solomon, after completing the sanctuary, he went to the altar. He prayed to God, and God heard his prayer. Noah, after the flood, he arranged for an altar for God, and God heard the smell of the sacrifice, to the extent that God had to renew the covenant he had with men. But this time around, God specifically demanded for this altar from Jacob. And the first step that Jacob took was to instruct his people, all the foreign gods, all the foreign objects that we're having with you, please submit it. Because he did not want the altar of God to be contaminated. Every one of them delivered, except Rachel. These foreign gods, Jacob buried them under the tree of God. And also told them that they should change their garments, just like we have in Zechariah 3:3, where God instructed Joshua, remove these filthy garments from you. He was preparing his family for the altar of God that must be totally purified, that should not be contaminated. What is an altar of God? To start with, an altar of God is a place that is most purified in all sanctuary. It's a place of sacred place. It's a place that is referred to as holiest of the holy, the altar of God. But like I said, this altar of God we are talking this morning is not an altar that is built by a man, but an altar that is built by God himself. And that is why the theme for today's sermon shall be altar of God. When after building the altar, he told his people, he went out into the journey back to the land. But the altar of God in you, because we are told in the scripture that our body is the temple of God. And thus you have this temple, you have an altar there. Inside that temple of God, that is your body, we also have an altar. What type of altar do you have there? Is it altar of God or altar of Baals? Because there are two, principally there are two types of altars. You may have the altar of God, and we have the altar of Baals, where evil spirits dwell mightily. But I believe that we all have altar of God.
Amen.
The second lesson, also verse 8, told us about another altar of God.
Blessed are the pure in heart.
Blessed are those people that are pure in heart.
For they will see God.
For they will see God. God bless you. So the order of God that we're talking about is our hearts. Where all thoughts are being carried out. Where all actions are being carried out. Psalm 15, what does it tell us?
Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary?
God, who may dwell in the sanctuary?
Who may live on your holy hill?
Who may live on your holy?
He whose walk is blameless.
Him whose work is blameless.
And who does what is righteous.
And who does what is righteous.
Who speaks the truth from his heart.
Who speaks the truth from his heart.
And has no slander on his tongue.
And had no slander from his heart.
From his tongue.
From his tongue.
Who does his neighbor no wrong.
Yes.
And casts no slur.
Yes.
On his fellow man.
Yes. God bless you.
Amen.
He's telling us, what are the things that you have to find in the altar of God that is in your body. Every service day, we do read Psalm 51. And verse 10 there says what?
Create in me a new heart, O God.
Create in me a new heart, O God. I'm sure not many of us take cognizance of it each time we are reading it every Sunday or every time that we have service. It's only someone that is constant. Even if you are doing any ceremony, you must read it. If you are doing wedding, you must read it. Pure heart. That is the altar of God in your body. It's your own altar of God purified. It's your own altar of God sanctified. What are those things that you have in the altar of God? Altar of God. You must keep this altar of God pure all the time. Because if you do not do this, the evil spirits will go in there and it will reside there. And once it resides there, you might find it difficult to get him out. So, the first king of Israel was having Holy Spirit residing in him. But because he was not in consonance with God, the evil spirit came over him and flushed out the Holy Spirit he was having. And the evil spirit started from envy. And from envy, it graduated to jealousy. And from there, it graduated to hatred. And from there, it graduated to murder. Envy. One of the evil spirits that resided in the temple of Saul, the king. What type of spirit do you have in the temple of God that you have? I said, the temple that we have in this world, like I said, it must be kept purified. And in fact, you have the oldest place there. And the oldest place there is the only place that the high priest goes once in a year. And the high priest must purify himself. And in fact, before he goes in there, there will be a chain that will have been tied to his waist. So that if he goes in there and has committed anything whatsoever and was struck dead, the chain will be used to drag him out from the inner altar. Like I said, nobody goes in there. And at the same inner altar we have here, you will observe that the hardly do you have anybody that stays inside the inner altar. It is only meant for whole high priest too. And that is the pastor. Nobody sits down there. Nobody goes in there. Because it is meant for the high priest of God. And Celestial Church of Christ, our own high priest, is the founder. It is the pastor. So also the body of Christ, the altar of Christ in your body must also be kept purified. All the time, it must be kept purified. Otherwise, the evil spirits will come in and stay there. As we all know, an empty heart is the workshop for Satan. The heart in us is the altar of God. And that is what we are discussing this morning. Judas Iscariot was once having Holy Spirit residing in him. But because his heart is not fertile enough for the Holy Spirit to stay there, the Holy Spirit went out and the evil spirit went in there. Someone whose name had already been written in the book of life, his name had to be deleted because he was possessed by evil spirits. Someone that was one of those people, one of the tools that Christ was sending out for evangelism, he has given them power over any sort of darkness. He was later casted into a fire. That shall not be a portion in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Mary Magdalene, he was also having a terrible and notorious seven spirits residing in her. But the very day he had contact with Christ, the Holy Spirit left her. And the evil spirit left her. And the Holy Spirit now resides in her mightily. So mightily that he was the first to see Christ after resurrection. Someone that had already been condemned with seven notorious evil spirits. Not one, not two, not seven. But immediately he had contact with Christ Jesus. The evil spirit left her and the Holy Spirit went into her. She was so busy in the Christ ministry that it was even using substance to support Christ. And that is one of those weapons that you need to have if you are to fight the evil spirit. If you don't want the evil spirit to come and stay in the altar of God in your body, you must constantly read your Bible. You must constantly pray. As one knows very well that a prayerless Christian, powerless Christian. As Christian, we must pray constantly. We must meditate day and night in the word of God. And of course, we must give him praises all the time. If you are able to do this theory, I tell you, evil spirits will flee from you.
Amen.
Or are you like Paul the Apostle? Of course, we all know the activities of Paul the Apostle. He was also a notorious person. His only assignment then was to crucify the Christians, was to kill them, was to imprison them. And in fact, he even said in that age that when Stephen was being stoned, he was there. Those people that were stoning Stephen, they collected their addresses, bring the address, let me go there for you. And make sure that he was stoned to death. But when he had contact with Christ Jesus on his way to Damascus, he became a changed person completely. And in fact, he said, among the disciples, he was the youngest. But none of these disciples can claim that he worked more than he did. Yes, he was given seven spirits of God. He doesn't need to go and visit the sick people. All he needs to do is just to take his loin, take it to her in Jamaica, take it to her in Nigeria, Take it to him anywhere. Just place it on me. And we'll be well. He was once a notorious person. He was crucifying the Christians. He was hurling them to prison. He said he was even a chief sinner. But when he had contact with Christ on his way to Damascus, he changed completely and became a vessel of honor for Christ. When he was being told by the prophets that the person that has this line, problem is awaiting him in Jerusalem, you should not venture to go. And he was told, he said, why are you making me miserable? Why are you making me unhappy? Why are you creating fear in my mind? Just to go to Jerusalem and receive punishment, this name that I believe in, I'm even ready to die for the name. That is the power of the Holy Spirit. That was the man that the altar that was formerly occupied by evil spirits now allows Holy Spirit to dwell mightily in it. What are the characteristics and what are those things that if you are doing it, it's not the Holy Spirit that resides in you, but evil spirits? Proverbs 6:11.
So shall my poverty come as one that travaileth, and thy want as an armed man. Proverbs 6:11, right?
11:6.
So shall thy poverty come as one that travaileth.
Seven things God abhors.
6:16.
Six things that the Lord hates.
Six things.
Yea, seven of
God.
Take
it easy now.
There are six things the Lord hates.
Don't put me to an express. I'm just on the service lane. I'm okay with that. Can you come again?
There are six things the Lord hates.
I'm even like the tongue you're using now. There are six things that God hates.
Yea, seven are an abomination unto him.
Seven are abomination to God.
A proud look.
A proud look.
A lying tongue.
A lying tongue.
And hands that shed innocent blood.
And hands that shed innocent blood. Do you think those people call Boko Haram in Nigeria, do you think they have altar of God in their hearts?
No.
They shed innocent blood.
Yes.
The altar they are having there is out of Satan. Or you see a young boy crossing your lawn and you went inside and you trigger your gun and kill this boy. You think the Holy Spirit that resides in such a person?
No.
It's possible. Or you went totally against instruction and commandment of God that you should not do this, you should not do this, you should not do this. And you took God for granted. What can you do after all? And went ahead to do those things. Do you want to tell me that it is the Holy Spirit that resides in the mind of such people?
No.
Go on, sir.
A false witness that speaks lies.
Yes.
A heart that devises wicked imagination.
A heart. We are saying that the heart is the altar of God in the temple of your body. And they are now telling us that heart that you claim to be the altar of God in the temple of your body, that is what?
That devises wicked imagination.
That devises wicked imagination. There's nothing he thinks inside that heart that than how to do wickedness, than how to destroy people, than how to kill. In Nigeria, there was a time a couple, they were fighting. over a girlfriend. Yes. And what the woman had to do is to go and pour acid. Well, he said, this woman came to be a Christian who pour acid on the girlfriend. Do you want to tell me that such people or such person has Christ's altar in the temple of her body? Yes, sir.
Feet that be swift in running to mischief.
These types of people, in my Bible, they call them busybody. When I read it, I underlined it. I said, oh, Bible too also makes this type of a language. It's a busybody. They don't have any other assignment to do than to be running from one house to house, from one family to family, to destroy. Didn't you hear what he said during the harvest? Didn't you see what he did in the harvest? That's the assignment. Such person, we have been told this morning that such person has an altar of Satan, not that of God. Yes, sir.
A false witness that speaks lies.
Oh, the false witness. False witness. False witness. This class of people, when you call them to come and witness something they did not see, they will so witness and you feel that he or she was even part of it. Yes. Because along. He was not there. If you are among this class of people, you are not having the altar of God in your heart, but altar of devil. Yes.
He that sows discord among brethren.
Oh, discord. He is not happy if everything is at peace. Is not happy. That spirit in me or her will find means of causing discord. Yes, sir. Then Romans 1:25-32. Romans 1.
Change the truth of God into a lie.
They change the truth of God into a lie.
And worship and serve the creature more than.
They worship. They worship creations more than the person that created this.
Who is blessed forever?
Who is blessed forever? And that was what Rachel did. When Jacob asked all his people, bring the foreign gods we have with you. Don't go to that altar. God instructed me to prepare for him because I don't want any contamination. He left his father's house with this idol. And when the father was looking for it, he sat on it. And he told his father, you see, I cannot stand up because I'm passing through my period. And Jacob said that none of his family is having his idol. But anybody that is found with such person will be killed. And when she was having labor on Benjamin, he died during labor. The same thing with Achan in Joshua 7. The Israelites went into war with the Philistines and they were brutally massacred. They were killed in thousands. Joshua went back to the drawing board and asked God, why? Why? I didn't have this type of covenant with you. And God told him, go and search your people. And they searched and they found. And Achan was thrown to death because he was keeping an idol in his possession. And that was the reason why the Israelites were defeated in the battle. The same thing Aaron did. When Moses did not come back from the mountain in good time, and they are worried, he told them, bring your earrings, bring your trinkets, bring everything. And they brought them to him, and molded a graven image of cow. And now told them, Israelites, that is of God. Cow, to finish you, that is of God. I brought you out of Egypt. And God was totally provoked. And God told Moses, let me wipe out this generation and create another generation from you. But Moses told God, please do not do so. And God upheld the plea of Moses. This same Aaron, you remember his two children, they brought foreign incense before God. He has not learned lesson there, no. They brought foreign incense before God, and God killed them. You know the offense of God in this particular issue. The offense of God was that when they are about to leave Egypt, God told them, Moses, tell this my people to ask for whatever they want from the Egyptians, because I've put it in their mind to favor them. And in fact, the very night they were leaving, Moses did not even remember. It was God that reminded him, tell these people to ask for anything they want from the Egyptian, because we have served them for 430 years. You should not live empty-handed. No. Ask for everyone they asked. And they were giving trinkets, jewelries. It was this same trinket and jewelries they gave to Aaron. And from east, Aaron carved out an image of cow. That was the offense of God, though, for asking them to ask favor, that has given favor to them. And whatever they asked, the Egyptians will give them. Any riches that will take your salvation from you shall not be your portion.
Amen.
You should be able to differentiate the altar of God from that altar of Satan. I think the time is fast gone. Let me quickly tell you, let me round up by telling you 12 things that you start to gain if you allow the altar of God, which is your heart, to function in the way of the Holy Spirit. One, apart from the fact that the Holy Spirit resides mightily in you, nobody will be able to wage any war against you. Because the Holy Spirit will fight your cause for you.
Amen.
And so shall it be.
Amen.
Because Jacob had the temple of God and had the altar of God residing in him. When he went to Laban, the fortune of Laban witnessed a turn around. His presence in the house of Laban was like that Joseph's presence in the house of Pontifer. Three, when he wanted to leave the place, Laban did not want him to go with anything, but God fought his cause for him. And Jacob left the place stupendously rich. He went down with all his staff, Opa, Nkolomudo Laban. By the time he left the place with about 16 or 17 people. And he eventually got to his final destination with 16 people. 12 plus 3 plus 1. Not only that, he was also blessed with a lot of cattle and animals. And when Esau saw it, he said, hey, Jacob, my brother, how come with all these animals and all these people? He said, it is my God who blessed me in my sojourn. Not only that, when he was going, he was terrified. He did not know the impression or the approach Jesus was going to give him. He prayed. And when he saw Esau, what did Esau do? He just hugged him and kissed him. If man's way pleases God, God promises that he will make his enemies to be his friend. So say the book of Proverbs. Not only that, when the altar was built, God told him, all the people around you, they will not give you any problem.
Amen.
They will not worry you.
Amen.
God will fight a battle for you.
Amen.
And so shall it be.
Amen.
So throughout the sojourn of Jacob, nobody troubled him. And that is anointing of God. He is my anointed. Do not touch him. And we get to verse 9 of this to this sermon also. He told us, God has sat Jacob down. What is your name? And you know God knew Jacob's name already. And now we establish the covenant he had with Abraham. That this covenant I had with Abraham, I'm going to establish it during your time. That promised land, I promise Abraham, I will take you there. And if you look around today, you will see the 12 tribes of Israel. That was the covenant. And those are the things that you give if you give God a chance in your heart. And the second lesson, he also told us, he gave us the way of eternal salvation. That if you go through this path, we shall inherit eternal kingdom. And so shall it be for you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And notice something.